Somebody help me! I need a flight effect!
In this second video of our Superman Man of Steel miniseries, we're going to show you how to actually create the 3D environment and make it look like your actor is flying through the sky. If you missed the last video, Tom showed you how to set up your scene and film your footage using a couple of things you can find around the house. A lot of great tips in that video, so definitely check it out if you're looking to film something yourself. This tutorial is part two of a couple that we have planned, so be sure to subscribe and ring the bell so that you get notified when we next upload. We're going to break this tutorial down into sections, so if you're more interested in a specific technique, feel free to skip ahead to the timecode linked in the description. So now that Tom has kindly filmed our footage, let's go ahead and dive right into HitFilm and get started. Here we are inside of HitFilm Express, and the first thing I'm going to do is change the workspace. This is going to make it easier to edit and look at the different panels. So I'll come up here to Window, Workspaces, and then select the compositing workspace. This will get rid of the trimmer since we don't need it because we're not editing, and it will make the controls panel a lot bigger. Now come over to the media panel and make a new composite shot out of your footage. I'll go ahead and call this one Actor Isolation because that's what we're going to be doing. Hit OK, and now we should have a composite shot with just Tom's footage inside of it. So if you're shooting on a green screen and your footage looks like this, where there are things that aren't the green screen inside of your shot, you have to mask them out so that they don't stay there. Let's select the footage and come up to the freehand mask tool. And then I can use the scroll wheel to zoom out if necessary. And what I'll do is just create a mask. If you click and drag, it'll create a curve. And once I close the shape, you can see that Tom is now isolated. I'll go ahead and increase the scale of his layer a little bit so that the black line at the bottom isn't so visible. Now we can start removing the green screen. There are a couple different options for green screening depending on if you're using HitFilm Express or HitFilm Pro. If you're using Express and you want to stay completely free, you can use either the Hue and RGB key or the Color Difference key. If you're using HitFilm Pro, I would recommend the Chroma Key effect because that has the best formula for removing green. So let's go ahead and search for Color Difference key and drag that onto our footage. The color green is the default, so now we just have to adjust some of the sliders to get rid of most of the green. If you select View Matte, you can see a grayscale representation to get an idea of what your layer looks like. So I'll go ahead and adjust the sliders here until Tom is mostly white. You'll notice that the bottom section that Tom is resting on didn't get keyed out, and this is because it's quite a different and darker shade of green than the rest of the scene. That's okay though, we're just gonna mask it out. So once again, I'll select the layer and select the freehand mask tool, and then I'll click and drag to create a shape around this bottom chair. Come over to the controls panel and set the blend to subtract. This will remove it from the scene. If you want to adjust the edges of your key, you can search for the matte cleaner effect and drag that after the color difference key. You have a few options to adjust the smooth, the feather, which is how blurry the edge is, and the choke, which is how far it extends into your actor. Finally, I'll throw on a spill removal effect, and that will get rid of some of the lingering green color in Tom's layer. So now we've got our actor keyed out, and the benefit of doing this is that we can pre-render the composite to speed up our workflow. To do that, come over to the media panel, right-click the layer, select pre-render, and then make pre-render. If you make a change inside of the composite after it's been rendered, you'll have to render it again. With that done, we can move on to the background. For the background of this shot, I actually just used a single stock image, replicated multiple times. Let's come over and create a new composite shot, and I'll call this one Environment. Hit OK, and then bring in the stock image that we'll be using. This is from pexels.com, so it's free to use and free to download. The technique that I used for this isn't new. We've covered it several times in a few different tutorials. First, I'll come over and select this checkerboard icon and change the layer to a 3D plane. You might get a pop-up asking if you want to create a camera, and in this case, we do. What we're going to do is duplicate the layer multiple times and spread those layers out in 3D space. This first layer here will act as the farthest background layer. So I'll go into the controls panel, drop down the transform properties, and then set the position to something really far, like negative 7,000. I also want to flip the layer because technically in this shot the sun is on the right side, and in the case of this picture it's on the left. So I'll unlink the scale property, and then type negative 100 in the X value. Then I can link the scale again, and increase it to compensate for how far back it is. Before we start placing the other cloud layers, let's animate the camera so that we have an idea of how things are moving. Select the camera layer and come up to its transform properties. Activate keyframes for the position property, making sure that your timeline indicator is at the very start. Drag it to the end, and then drag the Z position forward to move the camera back in 3D space. If I play it, you can see that the camera is getting farther and farther away from this 3D layer of clouds. And because it's gone farther, we also need to bump up the scale of the picture itself. So it'll be pretty big at the start, but it will get quite far at the end. Now what we need to do is duplicate this layer and spread it out in 3D space. So right-click the layer and select Duplicate. To help you visualize what's going on, I'll create two views inside of my viewer. So down here where it says Views, I'll change that to 2. And then I'll set one of them to Perspective. I'll use the Orbit Camera tool to swing around my scene. And you can see that the cloud layer that we did first is pretty massive, and we've got the camera here. And if I play through, you can see it back up in 3D space. We've got two cloud layers now, so what I'll do is bring this one forward and just reposition it until a good looking cloud is in the frame. So maybe this one here. If you need to decrease the scale, you can do that as well. You'll notice that the second cloud's image is blocking a lot of the first one. To fix that, what we'll do is come up and add the demult effect to the second cloud layer. This will get rid of the dark areas and keep the light. So I'm not a fan of the way that this big cloud in the middle here currently looks. I like the way these ones at the bottom do, but I just want to isolate those so that this top cloud doesn't show. To do that, I'll just select the bottom layer and once again select the freehand mask tool. You can also use the rectangular or the ellipse depending on what your scene calls for. And I'll just draw a shape around the bottom here, so that only that portion of the second clouds layer is the one that shows through. Then in the controls panel, I'll feather the mask a bit. And now we've got a little bit of depth in our scene once that second cloud layer starts to show through. I'm also just going to add a curves effect before the demult, and this will get rid of more of the darkness of the cloud. The thing to remember about this environment is that it's going to be very blurry. There's going to be a lot of zoom blur and motion blur going on, so it doesn't necessarily have to be perfect. It can look a little bit weird before you blur it, and a lot of that will get hidden once we apply the blur. So now with this second layer done, I'll go ahead and do what I did before and duplicate it. I might also just drop the saturation a little bit because it is quite blue. Now I'll repeat the steps and go ahead and duplicate this layer again, but I'll place it even closer to the camera in 3D space. Be sure to vary the position and rotation of the clouds so that they don't all look exactly the same. Don't forget that you have a mask on it as well that can be moved. For this one, I might just flip it completely upside down and see how that looks. These clouds are looking a little bit sharp, so I'll go ahead and add a diffuse effect. A diffuse is basically a blur, but with a lowered opacity. So now just repeat these steps as many times as you need to create a dense cloud environment. In the final shot, I think I ended up having upwards of a dozen different cloud layers, but they were all the same picture, just placed at different points. If you notice a seam in one of your layers, a quick way to fix that is to select the layer and then double-click the rectangular mask tool. This will create a mask that is completely around the borders of the layer. Then what you can do is come in and feather it, as well as decrease the expansion to choke it in a little bit. You might have to change the blend mode so that it interacts correctly with the other masks that you have created. Here's a top-down bird's eye view of my scene. You can see all of the different cloud layers represented as white lines and the camera moving through them in 3D space. I don't want to spend too long on this because you can spend a really long time making a bunch of different layers and creating a really complex 3D scene, but let's go ahead and move on to compositing Tom inside of this environment. Once again, I'll create a new composite shot and call this one Assembly. Then I'll bring in the environment comp as well as Tom's actor isolation. Don't forget as well, once you're done with the environment, you can also pre-render that to speed things up. So here we've got a basic rough version of Tom flying through the sky, and it doesn't look great, so we're going to do a couple of things to improve it. The first is to blur the background. So for that, I'll come up and select the lens blur effect, and I'll drag that onto my background layer. You don't want to crank this up too high because the camera shouldn't technically have that much depth of field, but I'll go ahead and hide some of the minor details by setting it to maybe 25. I'll also add a zoom blur to help with the idea of motion, I'll add that on and set the strength to something negative so that it appears to get sucked into the center. Maybe negative 10. And then I'll move the control point over to where Tom is so that the motion appears to come from that direction. I knew when we were filming this that we wanted to aim for a 235 letterbox, so the fact that you can see the bottom of Tom here and that he appears cut off doesn't really matter because I know that I'm going to add a letterbox effect, and that's going to hide some of the details once I frame him up correctly. Going back into the environment comp real quick here, one of the things I would recommend is turning on motion blur for each of the layers, and that's this button here. You can click and drag to turn them on all at once. And depending on how fast you've keyframed your camera, that might make a major difference in the smoothness of the comp. Let's start with a simple curves effect on Tom to get his black and white levels at the right place. So I'll go ahead and add that in and make some space. And I'll drag the left end of the curve down to add contrast, and the right end up to increase the brightness. This is dependent on your scene, so if your Superman effect takes place at night, it will look a lot different to what we're doing here. Another thing that will help the composite is the light wrap effect, and I'll drag that onto Tom's layer. And from the source layer, select the environment. This will make the light and color wrap around Tom's layer, which will help sell the idea that he's in the same environment. One of the mistakes people make with light wrap is they make it too strong. You shouldn't really consciously recognize that there is light wrap going on in the scene. It should just complement it and be there as a sort of hidden effect. We can add a couple extra environmental bits to help blend the two layers together. When we shot this, we knew that we wanted the sun to be on Tom's left side, which is why you can see a highlight here on his head. To fake the idea of a sun on the right side of the screen, what I'll do is create a new plane, and then add the radial gradient effect onto it. I'll set the inner and outer radius to something a bit more orange, and then set the blend of the plane to either add or screen. Make sure this goes below the letterbox as well. You can drag the viewer handles or use the slider in the controls panel to change the size. I'll then put it over here on the right. If it's too strong, you can either make the color darker or decrease the opacity in the transform properties. I might also have Tom's layer grow over time, so to do that, what I'll do is come over to the scale property and activate keyframes for that, skip to the end, and set it to a higher number. I don't want to make it too obvious, it should be quite subtle. I might just add a hue shift on Tom's layer, because even though we use the spill removal effect, he's looking a little bit green, so I'll just shift the hue, maybe negative, something less than 10 or so. Maybe I'll bump the saturation up as well. It's also physically impossible for me to do a visual effect without using lens dirt, so I'll go ahead and drag that effect onto the grade layer below the letterbox. As indicated by the orange add-on button and the watermark that appeared, the lens dirt effect is part of the VFX Retro Pack 2 for Express, so you'll need to purchase that if you want to use it in your final short. But you can still use it in the comp and see how it'll look before you make that purchase. In the media panel, I have a picture of real lens dirt that I'll drag into the composite. And then I can hide it from view because it doesn't need to be seen. In the lens dirt effect under dirt layer, I can then select that picture, and it will use that texture, which is much more realistic. You can increase the intensity to your liking, and I'll just increase the blur a bit as well. If you're going for a Man of Steel color grade, one effect that's really good for that is bleach bypass. I'll set that to something more subtle, like 50%. I can also use the shake effect to create camera shake. I wouldn't recommend dropping the shake effect on and leaving it at that. Really take a look at the different controls and customize it to fit your scene. You can change the seed to get a different variation of the camera shake. I'll also increase the smooth, and you can also adjust the individual controls, so how much it shakes in the X direction, in the Y direction, and how much it rotates as well. Technically, this should be placed below the lens dirt. The lens dirt shouldn't shake. One of the things that will really help sell the idea of motion is particles flying across the screen. So let's go ahead and create that now. Keep in mind that the Particle Simulator is an add-on, so you can do it inside of HitFilm, but if you haven't purchased it, you will get a watermark. Once again, I'll create a separate comp and name this Particles. Then I'll drag in the Particle Simulator from the effects panel. This is what we start with, and I'll come into the controls and change the emitter shape to quad, so that instead of emitting from a single point, the particles can be spawned anywhere inside of this rectangle. I'll go ahead and increase the scale and height because I want these particles to be behind the camera flying at Tom's face. I'll change the trajectory from random to cone, which means they will go in a specific direction. And then I'll rotate them around so that they're going away from the camera. You can see they're not visible at the beginning. To fix that, search for shift, and then adjust the time shift to something negative. This means that the particles will be going for 10 seconds before the shot starts. Let's increase the speed quite a bit. And I'll also decrease the radius as well, because they're going a bit too crazy right now. So I'll say 5. Let's decrease the life so that they are on screen for less time. And I'll adjust the quad as well to make it a bit bigger. That's a good starting point. So let's go ahead and decrease the scale so that they're very small. And turn on motion blur as well. I'll leave them a bit bigger so that you can see them. But technically they shouldn't be too big. Now let's change one more thing so that they're fading in instead of popping in. What I'll do is select the particle system and come up to the lifetime panel. Select alpha and change the type to gradient. And add a black point at the beginning and end. This means the particles will fade in over their lifetime and then fade out as they go away. I can increase the particles per second to have more of them on the screen. And this is up to you to decide. Now that we've got one emitter set, we can right-click and duplicate it. And then in the appearance section, change the texture source to built-in. And then I'll choose one of the fire ferocity textures. And I'll increase the scale of this second particle simulation. I'll decrease how many are on screen. This is meant to be just a sort of fog going past Tom's face. And for this particle system, in the lifetime panel, I'll lower the middle slider to be more of a gray so that it's not as opaque. Let's go back into the assembly comp and drag the particles onto the timeline above everything else. It depends on which particles you use, you may or may not have to change the blend mode. But check how it looks and then make adjustments as needed. In this case, it's quite subtle, but it will help the idea of motion. Alright, so we've made good progress with this shot, but you'll notice that our Superman is missing his cape, and that is not going to fly. But we're not actually going to create the cape inside of HitFilm. I'm going to pass this shot over to Tom, and he's going to make one inside of Blender, including simulating the wind. If you're watching this video but haven't yet downloaded HitFilm Express, you can do so from the link in the description. And just a reminder, if you missed the first video in this series, you can find it in the card on screen. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.